This is the second time I've been to the UK. I did Milton Keynes in 2007, and I'm doing this one in 2012. So, I really only come here every 4 or 5 years.
Rare treat.
I don't know if it's a treat, but it's rare.
When you have been meeting fans, what's the most common question you get asked?
Let's see. Probably, did you think the movie was going to be a hit when it came out? That's a big one. How do those puppets work? Where's Gizmo now? Do you ever get tired of talking about Gremlins? Those are probably 3 or 4 of the biggest ones.
Let's get those out of the way first of all. First of all, when did you realize how much of a pop cultural phenomenon Gremlins was?
Well, I think everybody involved with it felt it like when it came out. I mean, because my life certainly changed within like the course of a week. You know, it was just a sudden kind of an impact thing. And then I think as the years go by, you kind of see it go through different, it almost evolves in a way. And so suddenly you'll be watching TV, you'll be flipping around the channels, and you'll land on Gremlins, you know, and you'll be like, oh, because it's always a little jarring when you flip around the TV and land on yourself, you know? And you land on it, and then afterwards it would say something like, you're watching TNT, you're watching Gremlins, the new classics. And you're like, oh, look at that. Now it's like considered like a classic. So like I find out it sort of trickles its way down to me. Like I don't go on Google and Google Gremlins every day. You just sort of gradually over the years you realize how many people have seen it and how many people's lives it affected in some positive way. And I think it has to do with the Christmas theme. You know, the fact that it's sort of a Christmas movie, so it gets trotted out every year. And people watch it over and over again. So I think that's kind of the secret to its longevity and the fact it's well made. It's a well crafted movie.
Well, it's that very much a beautiful kind of B movie homage. You know, I think there's just something very enjoyable. There's something fun about it, even though it is quite dark. Fans will have their favorite scenes, favorite moments. I mean, talking about the first film, could you pick one? Is there any particular ones that always make you smile when you see those?
Well, for me, the scene that was the most fun to shoot is the scene in the swimming pool, where the gremlin jumps into the swimming pool and the whole swimming pool just erupts into gremlins. That was incredibly fun because when we shot it, the whole swimming pool was wired with I guess it was liquid nitrogen. So when it jumps in, they hit a huge switch and liquid nitrogen was sent pouring into the pool. And I don't know if you know this, but when liquid nitrogen reacts with water, it's an incredibly violent chemical reaction. So much so that the entire ground is shaking when you do it on a swimming pool size scale. Yeah. So we didn't really know that until we did it. And then once we did it, the ground was shaking while we were shooting it. Everyone was like, that was pretty crazy. So that was really fun. For a 19-year-old kid to have the ground shaking, that was kind of cool. Well, you know, the thing is that the chainsaw wasn't in the movie. It wasn't in the script. It's in the movie, obviously. But Joe Dante and I were standing in between a break, and I said, there was chainsaws mounted just like as set decoration. I said, do you want to do a homage to Toby Hooper and do a Texas Chainsaw Massacre thing? And he's like, yeah, let's see if we can incorporate that into it. So that was right on the spot. And so we just did it. And the dangerous part was that on the shot where it's cutting into the bat, they had to use a real chainsaw blade. So I had to keep my hands just very steady. I mean, you've got 8 inches on either side, and it was locked down into a thing. But still, you've got a real blade there, and bits and pieces of the bat are flying into your face. Everyone goes, wow, it looks like it's really chewing the bat. I'm like, it is really chewing the bat. That's why it looks as cool as it does. So yeah, that was just kind of a bit of improv, really.
We're very glad it didn't chew you. You went on, of course, to do Gremlins 2, the new batch. Very different tonally to the first film. But no less iconic and memorable, I think, in a lot of ways. What do you think it is about the second film that again, gave fans something a little different from the first?
I think the thing about the second one is it's a deeply subversive movie. it's one of the only sequels that actively sort of trashes the first movie. I mean, it really mocks it in a pretty brutal way. So
it's quite postmodern as well, with the sort of the cinema breakdown scene and Hulk, you know.
A lot of breaking of the fourth wall, a lot of postmodernist stuff. And I think at the time people were just like, what? I don't think they really got it. Now, you know, more than 20 years later, there's no question they get it, because with the Blu-ray coming out, we got like a rave review in the New York Times. We got a great one on Gawker, which is a cool website. We just got a lot of glowing reassessment, I think, of the second one, whereas the first time around people were sort of scratching their head.
It's especially interesting that beneath the kind of the fun kind of B-movie camp value of these films, there are quite powerful moral messages. The first film's about man, don't mess with nature. Nature's going to come after you with a chainsaw. And the second film is, you know, it's very anti-capitalist. I think it seems very culturally appropriate now.
Yeah. Well, I'd love to say that the environmental message, or the don't fool with Mother Nature message, was really intended, but we didn't really even know what the ending of the movie was going to be until about the night before we shot it. They tried a bunch of endings and nobody was really happy with it. So they sent Chris Columbus away to do like another ending. And apparently that went on into the wee hours. And we didn't really find out what we were doing until they handed us the script the next morning. So we got there and we're like, whoa, okay, wow, cool, interesting. And then we just, you know, basically learned our lines and shot the scene in a couple of hours. Which is strange to think, you know, that now it's like, everyone really liked it. I guess, it, you know, when I tell people that, they're sort of stunned that it was sort of just kind of like thrown onto the end of the movie like that. But that's, we were working under a lot of time constraints to get it out for the next summer. So we had to move quickly.
Do you have a message to all of your fans, all the fans of Gremlins out there watching this all around the world?
Buy it on Blu-ray. I think it looks really good. I think the transfer looks really good. And my guess is it'll probably be the definitive and final version of the movie now that it's on Blu-ray. I mean, what are they going to do? You know, 2160 pixels? I don't know. 1080 is about as good as you can get, probably. So I think it's...
I think the only thing they've got left to do, Gremlins 3.
Gremlins 3. Yeah, well... The whole thing about Gremlins 3 is just the CGI versus puppet dilemma. And there's a significant financial difference between doing CGI and doing the puppets. And I think once they resolve that, if they ever do, then you'll see a Gremlins 3 or a reboot happen. Really depends.
I mean, would you personally like to get back on the franchise? Would you like them to do a third film and bring back Billy and the other characters?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think if you're going to do that, the way you do it is you just make myself and Phoebe the parents. Yeah. And you know, you make the kid, our child, who now would probably be about 15, you make that person sort of the star, you know, of the film, like the kid who was in Super 8. You know, you have him be like our kid. And then we sort of take over the Hoyt Axton, Francis Lee McCain roles.
I mean, have you ever spoken to Joe or Chris about those kind of ideas?
I actually saw something where Joe said he thought I was too old to be in the third one, and I was like, hello, too old. But I don't know, that's only if they're thinking of me still playing, you know, Billy, that version of Billy. You'd have to age him up appropriately and make it believable, so there you go. We'll cross our fingers.